river running free. You know how I feel. Blossom on the tree. You know how I feel. It's a new dawn. It's a new day. It's a new life for me. And I'm feeling good.
All right, welcome to part two of our series, Quitting for Good. Now, some of you get that opening video. Let me just kind of walk you through it for a moment because it's a great picture, really, of what this series is all about. The woman in that video, she's at a job. Obviously, it's a big company. But if you notice, she's writing on her to-do list, and one of them was she wants to work at her dream company. And then she changes her mind. I don't just want to work at my dream company. I want to start my dream company. In order to start her dream company, she had to quit where she was. And so she quits. And so as she's quitting, and you see all those people, she's quitting. Listen carefully. People that quit for good aren't people that quit because they're tired. They're people who quit to make space in their life because they can't do what's best by doing other things. We talked about it last time, and if you were here, we talked in part one about the fact that research shows that people who are the best at anything, the best in any field, sports, business, finance, relationships, even our spiritual life, even our being a fully devoted follower of Jesus, people who are the best at anything are the best at quitting. They're the best quitters, not because they quit, again, because they're bailing on something or it's too tough. No, they're quitting because I've got to quit what's good and even what's not so good and what's not essential in order to make room for the best that God has for me. And it's called strategic quitting. And people who quit in a strategic way, there are three questions they ask themselves. Let me show you on the screens. Strategic quitters who excel in life. See, again, some of you hear quitting, you think it means giving up. It doesn't. It means refocusing my energies and passion. They ask three questions. What am I doing now? Okay, the key areas of your life, what am I doing now? The second question, what do I need to be doing now? If I wanna become, if I wanna get there, if I wanna arrive, if I wanna change life. But the third question is, what do I need to quit doing now in order to do what I need to be doing now? See, you can't do it all. I have got to be a strategic quitter. I've got to quit certain things now, good things, bad things, lesser things, that I might do what I need to be doing now. And those three questions are really the essence of what we're going through each and every week in this series. Last weekend, we started this series by saying we need to quit playing God. One of the things that I'm doing now, that I need to quit doing now, is playing God over others and even playing God over my own life. And we talked last time about how we do that, how we play God over others, how we play God over ourselves, and how to quit. How do I quit playing God? Listen, I quit playing God so I can experience God. I quit playing God over others so I can have the best relationship with others. Because when I quit for good, I quit things that lessen my life so that I might experience more life. Now this weekend, we're gonna continue and look at another very important area in life in which we need to quit. And you see in your notes, I need to quit hurrying. We're gonna talk about the need, the importance of quitting hurrying. Now, it was a couple of years ago, and he's a very, very special writer, theologian, professor, passed away just a couple of years ago, Dr. Dallas Willard. Very smart man, very gifted man, deeply spiritual, follower of Jesus. He was asked this question: what's the key to a healthy spiritual life? What is the key to being spiritually healthy in every area of life? And after a long pause, Dr. Willard answered, "You must ruthlessly eliminate hurry from your life." The questioner then says, "What else?" Okay, I got that, don't hurry, but what else? Like, that can't be it. Like this guy's brilliant. There's gotta be more. How do I experience health in every area of life? After another long pause, let me pause there. How many of you know that really smart people, really wise people, take a long time to answer? It's like they think about it first. Like, who? They actually think. And so he paused. And then he said, there is nothing else. Like, time out. Like, you are incredibly brilliant, and you're a teacher and a writer and a theologian. There's got to be more than ruthlessly eliminating hurry. And he goes, no, that's it. If you want to experience health with God, health with others, health physically, if you want to experience health in every area of your life, you must ruthlessly eliminate hurry. Come on. Can that be true? Well, Scripture and science says it is. In fact, some of you may have heard the term hurry sickness. Let me tell you where it comes from. There were two cardiologists, Meyer Friedman, Ray Rosenman. And they started noticing the patients they were treating. They're always looking for the common denominator, what's causing these heart problems and heart attacks and issues and surgeries. And the one thing they started discovering among their patients that was like the common denominating, common factor that happened in so many of them was they were hurrying. And they coined this phrase, this diagnosis, hurry sickness. And in fact, I put it in your notes. I put their definition. Let's just walk through it for a moment. They define hurry sickness as a continuous struggle. So it's not just something occasionally you have a flat tire, so you gotta hurry. A continuous struggle and unending attempt to accomplish or achieve more and more things or participate in more and more events in less and less time. It's trying to squeeze more and more into our life in less and less time. Now, just work with me for a moment. How many of you may know someone who's suffering from worry sickness? And how many of you may see that person every day in the mirror? Because, like, it might be you. It might be me. The Bible tells us to examine ourselves. Interesting, it doesn't say examine the person beside you. It says examine you. So keep your elbows to yourself, and let's talk for a moment about us. And I want to walk you through some very important principles and some very important biblical truths about ruthlessly eliminating hurry from our lives. And the first one is that hurry sickness has some symptoms. And we need to understand the symptoms. We need to recognize them because often, especially people who have hurry sickness, don't even know they're hurrying. That's part of the sickness. Because it happens. So let me just walk you through. Just you can just listen. Let me give you a few of these now. You don't need to say amen. If you can't have to say something, you can say ouch. Just want to walk you through these. Now again, elbows to yourself. This is not about the person beside you. One of the symptoms of hurry sickness is you're always rushing even when you don't need to. Come on, how many of you ever, like, life's a rush and then you got a day off and you're still rushing? Have you ever found yourself rushing? It's like, I don't have to, but your motor's running. I read a report. So I was reading a lot of studies about rushing. And one of them is that people that have to wait at a microwave for more than 30 seconds have to do something else. It's just too long to stand there. How stupid is that? And then I said, I do that. Like 30 seconds, I'm not staying here. You get your phone out, you gotta do something with that 30 seconds. Because the motor's always running. Even when I don't need to rush, I'm rushing. Let me give you another one. A symptom of hurry sickness is when you're checking out, you always look for the express line and you count the person's items in front of you. No, wait. Out loud. One, two, like, can you read? This is the fast people line. Well, you know, stay with me. When you're driving and you're approaching a red light, there's several lanes, you're scanning for which car you think will leave fastest. Okay, like it's not that mail truck because they're not in a hurry. It's not the Prius driver. They're going to save the world, but they're slow. You're looking for the fastest. All right, let's try another one. You hate to wait anytime, anywhere. On anyone, even the elderly. Watch the screens. Ah. I've laughed every time I've watched it. I watched it a whole bunch of times. She must have bricks in that purse. I have no idea. That is hurry sickness karma right there. You just can't, you can't wait. You honk at old people. Like, hurry up. I got to get somewhere. Let me give you another symptom. It's being a gold medalist at multitasking. Now, there's some of you in this room who think that that's a gift. Again, it's been proven it is not. You think you do a lot of things well. You don't do those things as well as if you focus on lesser one at a time. That's been proven. Some of you in this room are so talented, you can drive with your knee while you're eating, while you're talking on the phone, while you're texting, which is against the law, and while you're putting on makeup, which should be against the law. True story. Like, I watch people. So I'm driving home. It's like about a week ago. I told my wife, I'm driving home. It's about 10 o'clock at night. And I just hit like every light. I hit every light. But the person behind me happened to be a woman. And every light we stopped, I saw her. She would turn the light on and she put makeup on at every light. Doing her eyes. Every light. See, flip the visor, turn the light on. And I watched her. Now, one of the reasons I watched her is because several months ago, I got rear-ended by a distracted female. So I watch people. I want to make sure the person behind me sees that I've stopped. And she's putting on makeup at 10 o'clock at night, going toward a neighborhood. I'm like, I don't even care. I don't want to know where you're going. But she was like, multitasking, as long as you keep driving. Like, no, we're not as focused, but some of you, that's your life is about juggling lots of things. Let me give you another. It is turning your kid's bedtime into a race. Okay, just be quiet. Don't say it. Just say ouch. All right, kids, let's see who can put on their pajamas, brush your teeth, go to sleep the fastest. It's not about them. It's the race for your time. Self-medicating in self-destructive ways. See, unrelenting stress and unsustainable pace just does a number on us. We weren't made for it. And we break down. Speed kills. I don't just mean driving fast. I don't just mean drugs. I mean the pace of life can just do a number on us. That's what the cardiologist discovered. And there are some of us that because of that, we try to medicate ourselves. Some self-medicate with like too much social media. Some try to medicate with too much TV. Some medicate with video games and pornography. What's really interesting is those two things are the two highest multi-billion dollar industries of self-medicating. And so many times people go to things to somehow chemically to make themselves feel better because the pace and pressure of their life is just unsustainable. So I try to find something to help me cope. Some gamble, some do drugs, some turn to alcohol, some turn to shopping and spending. I read a really interesting story. This man's wife, her credit card got stolen, and he didn't call it in because the thief spent less than his wife. Sorry, don't pass that on. I just walked through some of the symptoms, and the reason I know them is because a lot of those came right out of my life. Like, I realized, like, I went to a fast food place. How many know fast food is not good food, but it's supposed to be fast? That's why you go there. And I won't say where it was, but Kentucky Fried Chicken. So I went to this fast food place. And like, I'm going to get the healthiest thing I can get, like grilled chicken. And they're like, well, it's going to be 5 minutes. I'm like, I'm going to wait 5 minutes? True story. So I jumped in my car, drove somewhere else, got something else, and it took me 15 minutes if I just stayed there 5 minutes. But I couldn't stand there 5 minutes. It's got to be fast. So preaching to me. Do you recognize the symptoms? But we don't stop there, because many times when you're rushing, you don't even see the symptoms of rushing in your life. Sometimes those around you will. Let me give you a second very important insight, principle we need in Scripture, and it's this, that there are not only symptoms to hurry sickness, there are consequences to hurry sickness that we need to be aware of. The reason Dallas Willard said, there is nothing else, ruthlessly eliminated, is because of the cost. Let me just walk you through. There's many costs. Let me just give you three. I want you to write in your notes. And here's the first one. A consequence of living in a hurry is missing out on knowing and enjoying God. I just want you to write God. Psalm 46:10, many of us know this passage. Be what? Still and know that I am what? The flip side is rush and you'll never know me. Live life on the run and you'll never know me. You and I will never experience anything fully, deeply, to the maximum at Mach speed. It will only destroy us. And God says, you gotta stop. You gotta quit. You gotta be still and not just on the outside. How many of you stop on the outside, but the motor's running? The motor's running on the inside. It's like the accelerator is stuck. And God just says, you gotta be still or you will never know me. I wanna take you to the next step. You and I won't know God, we won't enjoy God. And let me take you to a story. Many of you know the story of Martha. She misses out on enjoying Jesus because of, one of the reasons was hurrying. Let me show you Luke 10, verse 38. Jesus and his disciples went into a village. A woman named Martha welcomed him into her home. She had a sister named Mary. Mary sat at the Lord's feet and listened to him talk. She got still. But Martha was what? Upset, circling, upset about all the work she had to do. Now, circle that word had. Just jumped out at me when I was reading this story. I've read this story so many, but she had to do this. Who made that had to do list? So she asked, Lord, don't you care that my sister has left me to do all the work by myself? Tell her to help me. Now, many of us know this story, okay? So one of the challenges as a speaker is when you already know the story, you're like way ahead of me. But just time out for a moment. Just stop for a moment. I was rereading the story, and one of the things that just gripped me was simply this. Martha had God, very God, in her house. Jesus, fully human, fully God, God in the flesh, was in her house. God, who made it all, is in her living room. And she's upset, and she's critical, and she's resentful, like, woo. And God is in her house. So why was she upset? And why was she critical? Why was she so resentful? Because, not because she was doing something wrong, serving, loving. See, it was her house. I can tell you that because especially in the Oriental culture, when they name people, the boss comes first. It was like Martha, Mary, Lazarus. Like Lazarus was last. You often read lists and it starts with Peter. And it has, why? Because he's first. And so this is telling us, and she was like, this was her house. She had the gift of hospitality. She was the organizer. She was the doer. But watch very carefully. Martha was so busy serving Jesus and his disciples that she missed enjoying Jesus and his disciples. Serving is not wrong. It's very good. But here's when serving becomes not so good. When you and I are so busy serving God that we stop enjoying God, that we get resentful with others, watch resentment. Watch when you start getting ticked with everybody. Watch when you start thinking, nobody's doing what I'm doing. Because at some point that hurrying becomes a bad thing that keeps us from the best thing. And so Martha, because she could not be still, because she couldn't sit, she not only missed Jesus being there, she missed enjoying him. Let me give you another consequence in your notes of living in a hurry is missing out on loving others. What makes and grows a relationship is the one thing that hurrying people don't have time to give, and that's time. What makes a relationship grow, what makes a relationship thrive is time. In fact, the Apostle Paul writes this in 1 Corinthians 10. Look carefully. He says in 1 Corinthians 13, verse 4, love is what?
Patient.
Love gives time. Time to know and be known. Time to speak. Time to listen. Time before we get angry. In fact, one of the meanings of the word patience is to heat up slowly. That before I just go off on somebody, I give it time. Huh. Proverbs 14, verse 29, love this verse from the Message Bible. Slowness to anger, that is patience, makes for deep what? Understanding. Going slow, you'll understand things. Going fast, you won't. A quick-tempered person stockpiles stupidity. Like, just tell us what you really mean. Yeah. Slowness leads to understanding, and quickness leads to stupidity. I personally believe that what breaks up many marriages and families and friendships is the pace. Is the pace that is so quick, we miss things. We misunderstand. I don't take time to really listen to what's going on. I don't mean by the words. I mean, because the words are only a small part of communication. We see it. We watch it. It's the tone of voice. And I miss it when I'm rushing. And there's so many marriages, and I've counseled just hundreds and hundreds of people. And afterwards, if I'd only known that, why didn't I know that? I didn't understand that. And it's often because hurting people don't give their relationships time. They don't give their children time. They don't give their friends time. They don't give, and when time is missing, it's an incredibly costly consequence of rushing. Let me give you a third to write down in your notes. One of the most costly consequences of living in a hurry is missing special moments. I want you to write the word special moments. Ephesians 5, verse 15, Paul writes, "Be very careful then how you live, not as unwise, but as wise, making the most of every," what? "Opportunity." Now, we've talked about this passage several times. So if you've been here before, you know this part. If you haven't, just listen up. Even if you know it, still listen up. Because Paul is telling us something very important about time. And there are two Greek words used for time, and we've covered them. Chronos, we get chronology, chronological. Chronos time is clock time. It's how we measure our life. How old am I? We measure by clock time. It is the minutes and the hours and the days and the weeks and the months and the years. That's chronos time. That's clock time. Kairos time means event. It means opportunity. And Paul says, be very wise to use your clock time. See, your clock time is the most valuable thing you have. It's more valuable. You can get more money. You can't get more time. And I mean, even when you rush, you don't get more time. So time is the most valuable commodity we have, and the Bible says use your clock time to buy events and moments and memories. He says be very wise in how you spend your clock time for moments. Now listen carefully. If you and I don't slow down, you will miss great moments. If you and I don't slow down, we will miss moments. Now, let me help you with this because some of you don't look like you're getting it. Just watch the screens.
She was staring out the window of their SUV, complaining, saying, "I can't wait to turn 18. She said, "I'll make my own money and I'll make my own rules. Mama put the car in park out there in front of the school." And she kissed her head and said, "I was just like you. You're gonna miss this. You're gonna want this back. You're gonna wish these days hadn't gone by so fast. These are some good times, so take a good look around. You may not know it now, but you're gonna miss this." Before she knows it, she's a brand new bride in her one-bedroom apartment, and her daddy stops by. He tells her it's a nice place. She says, "It'll do for now. starts talking about babies and buying a house. And Daddy shakes his head and says, baby, just slow down, 'cause you're gonna miss this. You're gonna want this back. You're gonna wish these days hadn't gone by so fast. These are some good times, so take a good look. Of my own, one's 36, one's 23. It's hard to believe, but you're gonna miss this. You're gonna want this back. You're gonna wish these days hadn't gone by so fast. These are some good times, so take a good look.
Some of you need to listen to more country music. That's all I got to say. Y'all need to listen to more country. Now, what's powerful about that, obviously, on multiple levels, but you're going to miss this, is a clever statement. Not just you're going to miss it as I wish it was back, but if you don't slow down, you're going to miss it the first time. Speed causes us to miss memories. They will only be made if we slow down. I've got to use my clock time to buy moments. I was one of those kind of kids that I always wanted to get to the next thing. Like, I couldn't wait to get out of elementary into middle school, and I couldn't wait to get out of middle school into high school. Couldn't wait to get out of high school into college. Couldn't wait to get out of college and get married and then have kids. It's like my whole life, like I want to get to the next one, the next stage, the next step. And some of you understand what it's like, and it's nothing wrong with wanting to move forward, but it's the speed. And some of us rush through things and rush through life in such a way that we're going to miss it. We're going to miss it while, listen, it is possible to miss life while you're living it. And while I'm looking for the good, I miss the good if I go too fast. So Dallas Willard says, ruthlessly eliminate hurry. See, first of all, I got to understand the symptoms of hurry sickness, because sometimes I'm going so fast, I miss it. I got to understand the price I pay, because there are consequences to speeding through life. More than a ticket from an officer, there are costs of speeding through life. So how do I quit? How do I quit hurrying? How do I overcome hurry sickness? Well, God has antidotes for us, and that's the last thing I want to share with you. I want to share with you three antidotes that God gives us for overcoming hurry sickness. And here's the first one in your notes. Antidote number one, follow the right leader. I want you to write the word leader. I want to get as like gut level real with you as I possibly can. Let me just tell you the truth. You and I can't quit hurrying on our own. I just don't believe what happened. There are too many voices outside of us and inside of us. There are too many options. The speed of life itself. There's so much going on today. So much happens. So many things taking place that you and I cannot slow down by ourselves. We need help. And the way to slow down is to have a pace setter. The way to slow down is to have a leader of our life. I believe that leader is Jesus. I find it interesting that when he issued an invitation to know him, it started like this: follow me. Just follow me. If you follow me, I'll show you how to live. I'll show you not only how to live free, I'll show you a pace of life. Now I know, man, a lot of you have so much to do. Your mind right now, like you're half here because you got so much stuff to do. Let me tell you what, no matter what you have to do, you don't have to save the world. Jesus did. He came and had to save the world, and he didn't rush. Does that ever bother you? Like you never find Jesus rushing. Like, hurry up, you got to save the world. In fact, come on, Jesus, you should have started before you were 30. Like, you waited a long time to get started. You could have done stuff before you were 30. He's like 30. And then as soon as he's baptized, the Holy Spirit descends upon him, and God says, this is my son in whom I'm get going. And he goes out in the wilderness for 40 days. Come on, let's go, let's go, let's go. We got to save the world. But somehow he starts by stopping. He starts by this battle with Satan. He starts by learning self-control, and he learns how to delay, and he learns how to wait. And Jesus was never in a rush. And when you follow him, you will get a lot done, but it won't be by hurry. In fact, I ran across a really interesting paraphrase of Psalm 23. It's actually called Psalm 23 for Busy People. Let me show you. Put it on the screen. It goes like this. The Lord is my pace setter. I shall not rush. He makes me stop and rest for quiet intervals. He provides me with images of stillness, which restore my serenity. He leads me in ways of efficiency through calmness of mind, and his guidance is peace. Even though I have a great many things to accomplish each day, I will not fret, for his presence is here. His timelessness, his all importance, will keep me in balance. He prepares refreshment and renewal in the midst of my activity by anointing my head with his oils of tranquility. My cup of joyous energy overflows. Surely harmony and effectiveness shall be the fruit of my hours, for I shall walk in the pace of my Lord and dwell in his house forever. Who are you following? Sometimes you and I put it like this, we always need a pace setter. And when the Lord is my pace setter, I shall not rush. Because God has made enough time to do everything he's called us to do. He hasn't called us to do more, he's called us to be more. Here's a second. Antidote number two, learn when to say yes and when to say no. I want you to write two words in your notes, yes and no. Matthew 5:37, Jesus said, simply let your yes be yes and your no, no. Anything beyond this comes from the evil one. Those two words, yes and no, are life determining and they're life defining. Let me start off with their life defining. In the context, Jesus is talking about being truthful. You don't need to swear on something else, because when you say yes, you mean yes. When you say no, you mean no. You are a person of your word. So these words are about integrity. They define who I am. But they are also life determining. Those words set the boundaries of your life. What you say yes to, what you say no to, they determine where you're going in life, what's going to happen in your life. Proverbs 20, verse 25, watch. An impulsive vow is a trap. Later you'll wish you could get out of it. How many have lived that verse? How many of you have ever said yes to something, and when it came, you went, what was I thinking? I was not thinking. In fact, okay, we need to practice this, because some of us, I want you, many of us say yes, but many of us have not learned how to say no. So I want you just, not in an angry way, but I want you to turn to the person beside you and just say no, okay? Just real quick, just say no, okay? Say no. Okay, turn to the person on the other side, say no. Okay, now, don't have too much fun with this. Like some of you, that's the first time you said no to them without getting killed. So it's like, it's a God thing. Saying yes and saying no define the boundaries of our life. And the ability to say yes and no and to learn how to do them at a right time, because it's a lot easier to get into things than to get out of things. Let's go back to Mary and Martha. Luke 10, verse 42, the Lord answered her, Martha, Martha, you worry and fuss about a lot of things. There's only, how many? One thing you need. Mary has made the right, what? Don't miss, see, it's all about choices. And that one thing will not be taken away from her. Now again, I don't have time to go deep in this story other than to say Mary could not say yes to everyone and everything. Mary could not say yes to Martha's demand and Jesus' presence. It wasn't that Mary was lazy, that Mary didn't serve. But in this moment, what's the best thing? And so she had to say yes to Jesus and no to serving in that moment. I've shared with you previously, there's a great book written a couple of years ago by Andy Stanley. A really thought-provoking book with kind of a little bit of a challenging title. It's the title simply, Choosing to Cheat. Subtitle is, Who Wins When Family and Work Collide? And he really writes about this battle between yes and no. Let me just share a little bit of what he writes. Just listen up. He writes, so when I talk about choosing to cheat, I'm referring to the decision to give up one thing in order to gain something else. This is something we do every day. We don't think of it as cheating, especially when we're making what most people would consider a good trade. Saying no to dessert for the sake of one's waistline could hardly be considered cheating. But isn't it true that when you say no to dessert, you've cheated your appetite? Both you and your appetite and your self-control cry out for your attention. To say yes to one is to say no to the other. You can't have it both ways. Daily, you make decisions to give up one thing in order to gain something else. This is especially true of your schedule. You face a variety of responsibilities and opportunities, work, family, hobbies, clubs, leagues. The list is endless. Each competes for your most valuable resource, your time. But to give each the time it demands or deserves would require more time than you have, so you cheat. You allocate your time the best you can, knowing that all the while, somebody is gonna feel cheated. Choosing who or what we cheat is about establishing priorities. A priority is something or someone you say yes to, even when it means saying no to other things or people. When you choose to cheat in accordance with God's priorities for your life, it's an invitation for God to bless you in ways you never dared to imagine. See, the key is, yes and no are based on priorities. Whose priorities? God's. Whose standards? God's. Whose value list? God's. And if I will value what God values and tells me to value, and I'll seek God's priorities, seek his kingdom first, and all these other things will find the right place in your life, but I seek him first, I put him in the middle, then all the other things will find the right place, will be added to me. The question comes again, who am I gonna say yes to? Who am I gonna say no to? And I have to learn to say yes and no at right times and right places if I'm ever gonna overcome hurry sickness. And one more, last one in your notes is this. Antidote number three, schedule life refueling stops. Once you write the word stops. It was a number of years ago, I ran across this little refueling schedule and it just kind of stuck with me and I want to share it with you. I want you to write it down. I try to practice this because if you don't schedule it, it won't happen. Okay, so I want you to schedule stops. And here's the first one in your notes, divert daily. Every day, make a little diversion for a God connection. Doesn't have to be a long time. You don't have to pray for hours. It can be 10 minutes, it can be 20 minutes. You just take a few moments and you just connect with God. You talk and you listen. You take a few minutes in his word. Every day, just a few minutes in his word, and you just start to read just a few minutes every day. Every day, divert just for a few moments and do something that makes you smile. I mean that, every day, because life can get so serious. I was reading a study, how often kids laugh and how often adults laugh, and it's not funny. Because we just don't laugh, kids just laugh so many times, and laughter is medicine. If you're gonna self-medicate, medicate with smiles. I watched that video of that old lady whacking that guy's Mercedes. I keep that on my phone. That's just, this reminds me. Old people or something. So you just watch. You got to. I'm going to give you another one. I want to give you a key to diverting daily. Take naps. Do you know that naps can change your life? That's science. Listen, there's a doctor. Dr. Sarah Mednick is a sleep expert. She wrote a book titled, Take a Nap, Change Your Life. Here's what she writes. Here's a piece of it. Watch, listen. She says, you can get incredible benefits from 15 to 20 minutes of napping. Naps boost our brains, including improvement to creative problem solving, verbal memory, perceptual learning, object learning, statistical learning. Naps improve our mood, are healthy for our heart, blood pressure, stress levels, and surprisingly even weight management. In fact, I want to show you a chart. Here's a chart. She gives a chart of what happens when people take naps. Now, the optimum time is like 20 minutes. You go longer than that, you get into REM sleep, and it's like a whole different, you can't wake up. Like 20 minutes, 15, 20 minutes. Look at this chart. The person who takes no nap, the blue line, by 7 days have tanked. But the person who takes a nap, look at that red line. Like it dips, but then it jumps. Now, some of you are going like, yeah, I wish I could. Well, listen, Jesus did. It's in your notes. I want you to see it, okay? In your notes, Luke 8, verse 23. I want you to read it out loud with your voices because some of you don't believe me. Out loud. As they sailed across, Jesus settled down for a... Circle it. If Jesus can take naps, I can take naps. In fact, it's been proven once again that just that little diversion is an antidote for speed, for rushing, for hurrying, for hurry sickness. Let me give you a second antidote in your notes. Withdraw weekly. Withdraw weekly. Take a whole day off every week to recharge and renew. The Bible calls it Shabbat, Sabbath. The Israelites for 400 years were slaves and they had to work 7 days a week. And when they finally get free, they're free from Egypt, but they're not free from the patterns. See, the Egyptian gods say, work yourself to death. The real God says, take a day. And Shabbat or Sabbath literally means to cease, desist. It's like the blowing of a horn that says, you're off for the next 24 hours. You're off. All right, some of you, any of you ever grow up watching Fred Flintstone? That was like, he was like, man, I watched Fred. Remember when they pulled that horn, that bird yelled, and how many are familiar with the phrase yabba dabba doo? Anybody heard that phrase? Yabba dabba doo is what he said when he got off work, when he was off for the weekend. God wants you to have a yabba dabba doo day. That's the Sabbath. The Sabbath was made for man. Men turned around and made it a burden. God made it a blessing. It is a gift. And God says, you are not meant to go 7 days a week. And some of us think, if I just spend more time and more days, I'll get more done. And the truth is, you get less done. You not only get less done, you destroy yourself and others and everything along the way. So God says, I want you to divert daily. I want you to weekly withdraw. And have a Shabbat. Have a day that you just stop. And you don't do what you normally do. And you have fun. Literally, there's a psalm about play that you just enjoy because sometimes we don't enjoy life while we're living it. And then let me give you one more. Abandon annually. At least once a year, take a vacation or a staycation. What's important annually is that you take a long enough time to really turn off the motors and the pace and the engine and everything else that's running in your life. Because come on, how many of you on a 7 day break, the first 3 days you're unwinding, one day you're free, and then the next 3 days you're winding up again. And so God says, I want you to take an extended amount of time. And I believe vacations or staycations, whatever it is, there's just an extended amount of time that you just kind of shut down because sometimes you need a long charge, not a short charge for your life. Now, if you are ready to quit hurrying, stand up. Would you do that? Everyone is ready, I'm going to quit hurrying. I want you to stand up. And do not hurry for the door. Okay, like quit hurrying for the door. Okay, like, no, we're going to finish, I promise, but don't hurry for the door yet. Some of you, that's the habit you need to quit. Now, if you got to leave early, standing along the back so we don't see us. What happens is when you slip out, others miss, because the end is the most important moment of making decisions. I stand with you because I'm ready to quit hurrying. In order to quit hurrying, I got to recognize the symptoms, and I've got to recognize the consequences. But people that strategically quit ask themselves three questions. One more time. What am I doing now? What do I need to be doing now? And what do I need to quit doing now in order to do what I need to be doing now? And I want you to think through the essential areas of your life and ask yourself those questions. And when we do, here's what we discover. We discover we quit things I don't need to be doing now, so I can do three things. And I want you to read these out loud. That's with your voice, okay? Everyone together. The first thing, I quit hurrying so I can follow the right leader. Let God set the pace for your life. Jesus said, follow me. Not get ahead of me, just follow me. For my burden is easy, my yoke is just right for you, and I will set the right pace for your life if you'll walk with me. I quit hurrying so I can, say it out loud, learn to say yes and no. Doesn't mean you say no to everything. You say yes to some things, but you say no because it defines your life and it determines your life. So think about what you say yes and no to, and be willing to know that you're going to cheat somebody, and whoever you say no to is not going to be happy, but live for an audience of one. Everyone is not going to applaud you. It's going to happen, but live so God applauds you. And finally, I quit hurrying so I can, say it, I'll schedule life refueling stops. Now, everyone who's still seated, they're taking their nap now, okay? So that's all right. Just leave them alone. But schedule daily times to divert and weekly times to have a day, to withdraw a day and have a yabba dabba do day. And then annually have a longer time. And you and I will overcome rushing and quit hurrying. Let's pray. God, slow me down. Slow down this pace that is not from you. Slow us down in our time with you so we can really know you. Slow us down in loving others, because we'll never know them unless we give them time to think and talk and be and grow. Slow us down, Lord, so that we can see real values and buy them with our time and make memories that people that rush never have. Slow us down, God, to experience health like we'll never know if we don't ruthlessly eliminate rushing. If you've never surrendered your life to Jesus, that's the first and most important thing you'll ever do. And right where you stand, you can say, Jesus, forgive me of my sin. I want you to be my leader. Set the pace of my life. I follow you with my whole heart. And for others, Lord, who feel so overwhelmed by the unsustainable pressures and pace of their life, I pray peace. The Lord is my pace setter. I will not rush. You provide all that we need for all that you want us to be. In Jesus' name.